I can talk to you. Yeah.
Hello? Oh, I can't hear your audio. No. Nope. Are your earbuds plugged in?
I'm going to try that one. Hello?
Hello. There's somebody there.
Hello, Lourdes.
Hi, Daniel. How are you?
I'm doing good. Just give me a sec here. Let me get some lights here on my apartment so you can see me better.
Okay.
But how are you doing?
I am wonderful. Thank you for joining us today. We're just getting this started, trying to figure it out.
Ah, okay.
So where are you? Are you one of our Facebookers and WGN watchers?
Well, I am from Cedar Rapids, Iowa. I'm originally from Chicago. I do get WGN America on my cable provider.
All right, cool. So did you get a chance to watch the story?
Actually, I have not, but hopefully I will be able to if it's archived.
Yeah, so we'll end up putting it on the Facebook page and also on WGNTV.com. You can watch it on there. So this story was about the literacy rate at the jail, at the Cook County Jail. So they estimate that about 65% of the inmates, of the prisoners there, read below a seventh grade level. That's what they're thinking at this point. So they're trying to figure out some things that they can do to improve that number, and so it would help people once they go back out into the workforce to get jobs and fill out those job applications. So they've brought in libraries. They're working with a program called Open Books to bring in libraries and books to the jails, and then they're also changing some of the TV programming. So in the past, a lot of the inmates would sit around watching, you know, Jerry Springer and Maury Povich and tabloid TV. So they're going to take that out, and they're bringing in some educational self-help stuff. And it looks like we've got other people joining us, too.
Nice.
Who's our newest? Our newest visitor. Hi. I see him, but I don't hear him.
Looks like it's Ryan. So, Ryan, if you can hear us, unmute your mic.
Hey,
Ryan.
How are you?
Great. So this is all very new for all of us. We're trying to figure it out here.
Well, just to let you know, Lourdes, I have done a Google Hangout before.
Okay.
Of a different kind. So I think I might be able to help out some of you in case you need some help.
So you will be our technical director. Wonderful.
Hopefully, if I can help to the best I can.
So now, Daniel, you watch WGN-TV regularly?
Yeah, I watch the Midday News with Steve Sanders and Dina Bear.
Wonderful. Yeah, sometimes I get to fill in for Dina, which is nice.
Nice.
And Ryan, do you have any questions? Did you get a chance to watch the story tonight?
To be honest, I didn't, but I'm dating the web watcher, so I tune in.
All right, Ryan. Well, thank you for joining. So as I was explaining, the story is about the literacy rate at the jail, at the Cook County Jail. They think that it's somewhere at about 65% of the inmates, of the prisoners, read below a seventh grade level. So they're considered functionally illiterate. So the jail's been trying for years to come up with a way to maybe ease those numbers, improve them, so that these guys, when they go back out into the workforce, they can maybe have a better shot at getting a job and being a part of society, right, or a successful part of society. So what they're doing is they are bringing in libraries, like 6,000 books they've brought in already through this project called Open Books, and they are giving them out to the inmates, so that they start reading, and they're also changing some of the TV habits. So in the past, they used to watch a lot of Jerry Springer and Maury Povich and tabloid TV, and they're no longer doing that. They've taken that out, and they're bringing in some self-help and educational stuff to help them out.
I see.
How difficult was it for you guys to get on these Google Hangouts?
Let's see. I don't think it was that difficult at all.
Okay.
Since Google, since we have a YouTube account, it was easy for us to log on to Google Plus and stuff. So I think it was pretty easy for us to do it.
Okay. Well, I got to tell you guys, this is pretty cool to have this conversation with you on here.
Yes.
And so we've got Mike Baker. Is he on as well?
Mike, if you can hear us, unmute your mic. There you go.
Hi, Mike.
Hello.
Hi. I know you watch WGN pretty regularly.
Correct.
And you are one of our Facebook followers and Twitter followers, so welcome, Mike.
Thank you.
And Lourdes, I do follow Facebook. Do follow WGN on Facebook, so I do get the updates on the top stories that you guys are posting on Chicago.
Okay.
And I still call Chicago home, even though I live here in Cedar Rapids.
Cedar Rapids. What moved you to Cedar Rapids?
Mostly because I couldn't find a job in Illinois and wanted to be close to my mom and dad.
Okay.
But now I'm in the TV biz myself.
Okay.
Yep. I work for an ABC-affiliated TV station. I'm not going to mention the call letters, though, because I don't want to get in trouble.
Okay. I appreciate that.
I work behind the scenes.
Okay. So have you done these Google Hangouts before, I assume?
Yes, I have done. I've done one of a different organization.
Looks like we're getting somebody else on here. I'm trying to follow it. Mike, do you have any questions for us? You're pretty quiet over there.
I was curious why this took so long.
Why it takes so long?
Correct.
To try to get us set up on the Google Hangout?
No, about the news stories.
Why it took so long to do the story on the prisons?
Why did they not think about getting books in the library before?
That is a very good question, because I had the exact same question when I went out there. I actually always thought that they had libraries at jails and prisons. It seems, you know, pretty basic. And a lot of the prison programs do, but the county jails, a lot of times they just don't have the funding, they don't have the dollars to put something like this in place. And the way they've looked at it in the past is that these guys are in there for maybe a few months, 6 months, and that they can't really make much of a difference in their lives if they put in place a program when they're only going to take advantage of it for a short amount of time. They don't think it's going to give them any sort of payback. You know, they've not put this program in place, and oftentimes the inmates would get books from relatives or from employees at the jail that would bring in their books, their used books, and give them out to the inmates. So now they've partnered with this program called Open Books, which wasn't around in the past. And what they do is they collect gently used books or new books from different places, and they then give them out to the community. So sometimes they'll give them out to jails, they'll give them out to schools, they write grants to try to get funding for more literacy programs. So by partnering up with this organization, they were able to then bring the libraries to these jails. Was that the long answer?
Well, I was curious, because I was watching Channel 9 News, I just wondered why this wasn't considered before.
Yeah, that's a good, it is. You would think it's basic, right? It's common sense that they would do this at jails, but they just never did. They've had law programs or law books, so you'll go to a library and there is a spot for these inmates to go and read through the law books and maybe study up on their cases, but they've just never had library books in the past. They just couldn't do what they said.
Have you been to any other facilities?
Have they been doing? There are other facilities, not so much in Cook County, but through other states that do have small library programs, but they're very small programs. So at the division that I went to, at the Cook County Jail, it was maybe they had four or five shelves of books. And they also have to be very careful as to the types of books that they bring in. They go through all of the donations. They want to make sure that the books are not violent, there's no sexual content, that they're not going to be learning things that when they go back out into the real world they can use to harm people. So they're very careful as to the books that are being brought in. They make sure they go through them so that it's the right type of content that they want these guys to have. So that also takes some manpower, right? You've got to have somebody looking through the books and making sure that they're okay. And unfortunately, the jails don't always have that manpower and those extra dollars to put towards a program like that.
Well, see, you brought up a good point. But before, why do they let them watch such programs that would anger them or bring out bad points rather than try to steer the television watching to something better suited?
Yeah. Why were they watching tabloid TV?
Yeah, correct.
That's another really good question. You know what? I don't know what the answer to that is. It's just it was easy. I think nobody really cared in the past what kind of TV they were watching until Sheriff Dart started touring the jails and saying, look, this is doing more harm than good. We've got to do something about it, so no more of this television. And then also bringing in educational and self-help programming. Tailored for the inmates takes money as well. You know, TV programs aren't done for free, so they had to come up with a way to be able to offer them some more self-help educational stuff. And when they partnered with this organization, which is called Jail Education Solutions, that's when they were able to do it, because they then took charge of writing these grants and putting them in place so that the jail could get that type of programming.
Yeah, and I want to point off on the comment, Lourdes, that I think that was a great idea to partner up with this organization because, you know, some of these people that are in jail may not have the skills that they had when they were not in jail. So I think with this partnership, I think it's going to go a long way to help them, like I said, like they have these cases that they have.
Yeah,
I think that's a good idea to help them learn more of these cases, so that in case they get into similar situations again, don't know what to expect, so that they don't have a fear of the unexpected.
Yeah, and I know that I'm getting a number of tweets from people trying to get onto this chat, but they can't. I just got a message from somebody saying that they were trying to get onto the Google Hangout, but couldn't get through, so we'll have to figure that out. We'll have to work out the kinks.
You can, Lourdes, you can email them the link to the Google Plus Hangout.
Okay, yeah, that's what I just did with one of them.
So the link that's, in your browser bar, just go ahead and copy and paste it and send them a quick email.
Okay.
And they need to have a Google account in order to get into the Hangout.
Yes.
Okay, that's good to know. So Elise, you guys are hearing from her. She is our interactive web producer.
Woo!
Her very well. Ryan, say hello.
Hey.
Hi.
She's been helping me out coordinating some of this stuff and teaching me how it works while I learn it. So I appreciate some of her work. Thank you, Elise.
No problem. Yeah, so I'm just kind of soliciting questions on Facebook and Twitter right now to see if anyone else who watched the piece has a question. So I will keep you posted. And if there's anything, I will come back on.
All right, perfect. I just posted the address to see if people want to join in still on the conversation as we're talking.
Great.
So. I've got a question, Lourdes.
Okay.
So are they promoting more general education, or are they trying to build skills so when they, you know, are released from prison that they sort of are able to transition back into society?
Mm-hmm. It's a lot of different things. So they will do maybe a 30-minute show on how to fill out a job application, how to put together a resume. They'll do other things on self-help. So they might... you know, how to improve your self-esteem, how to become a better parent. So they'll have some things like that that are just general skills when you go back out into society. And then they'll do things like even just basic arithmetic, how to multiply, how to add, how to, you know, they'll do a literacy program. And then within that, they will also have some just normal, regular programming. So they might have a news show, or they might have, like I bet you tonight, the Bears game is probably something that they might have had on. So they'll do regular programming as well. So it won't be just educational or self-help, but it'll be a number of different things all together. And they said that this will actually be, Cook County will actually be the first in the country to do this type of TV programming tailored just for inmates. So it'll be interesting to see how it works. But in other places where they've done any sort of literacy programs or programs like this, they say that their recidivism rate actually drops, so that you've got fewer people coming back into the system. So we'll see if it actually works and helps in the next year.
Alright, are they going to do a follow-up study on this? Say like a few weeks or a couple of years down the road to see if people will actually gain any literacy stuff in this?
Yeah, I think that's something that we'll have to monitor, and they'll be monitoring as well, because you've got to think, if Cook County's doing it, there are going to be other counties wanting to follow in their footsteps and wanting to watch what they're doing. So I'm sure they'll come up with some numbers to back up the work that they've been doing.
Excellent.
Nice dog, by the way, Ryan.
Thank you.
Do you guys have any other questions related to news or anything you want to ask?
Well, unfortunately, with my provider, I only get the midday news and the news at 9. So unfortunately, I can't get the morning news and the news at 5. So sorry, Lourdes, I can't see at 5.
All right, you'll have to live stream it, okay?
Yeah, but I can watch the morning and evening news at online, though.
Okay.
We actually had some feedback from Facebook. People want to know where they're going to get the money for this, and someone said, let's educate those not in prison first.
Okay. So, and we've been talking about this. Sheriff Dart says that a lot of the money is coming through this program called Jail Education Solutions. So it's a group of just, I guess you can call them entrepreneurs, who decided that this was something that was worthwhile, and they've been raising the money themselves either through grants, and they just went to Sheriff Dart and said, this is what we can offer you. Are you interested? And he says that the dollars that it's taking him to put something like this together is minimal, so it's not really affecting their daily budgets. And then the library portion of it is through this organization called Open Books, which is a not-for-profit here in Chicago. And they go out, find the books, and then they decide who to donate them to, whether it's a jail or a school. So none of the dollars are really coming from the county.
Excellent, excellent.
All right.
I'm trying to work with somebody here who is trying to get in and is having difficulty, so I'm going to help them right now.
Okay.
Chances are it's probably his connection speed that's the difficulty.
Yeah, he said he's lagging, so that's probably it.
Lourdes, how did you get this assignment?
How did I get this assignment? Good question as well. So it's actually Marcella Raymond, who is one of the reporters here at the station. You're familiar with her, right, Daniel?
Yep, I've met her a couple of times.
Yeah, so she's one of our favorite reporters here at WGN, and she, I think, had some contacts at the jail, and they told her about it, and unfortunately she wasn't able to do it, and she said, what do you think about turning a story on this? And I thought it was a great idea, because we often talk about overcrowding at the jail and some of the issues that they're having, but we never talk about, well, what's being done about it? Is there anything that can be done about it? So she came to me, and that's how we linked up. It was interesting to go out there, because it's not oftentimes that you have access to the jail and you can go inside and do as you please. So it was interesting to be in there. It was definitely a lot more inmates than I thought. I think they said they have like 11,000 inmates at any given point. 10,000 to 11,000. That's a lot. We've got somebody else joining us, Derek.
Yes, Derek, if you can hear us, activate your cam, and if you can, get some lighting on us so we can see you. And turn down the background noise so we can hear you.
He's been ejected.
He's been ejected.
All right. Hi, Brian.
Hi.
Brian, if you can hear us, unmute your mic.
I'm unmuted.
Okay, we've got Derek off and we've got Brian on.
How you doing? I'm actually I'm one of the founders of Jail Education Solutions.
Oh, perfect. So great to have you. Nice to talk to you, Brian.
Yeah, sorry. I was lagging there for a little bit, but I just saw this as I came home. We just actually got back from the Rockford Jail, and we're talking with them about our technology and getting ready to sort of prepare for a launch there as well. So.
Okay, so let me explain to the folks who are on here. We've got Daniel and we've got Mike, and we had Ryan a little bit earlier, and they joined in the chat. It's the first time we do this, so thank you for joining us. They've had questions about how this Jail Education Solutions would work, how are you getting the money to put this programming on for the jails, and kind of what sort of programming you're putting in place. So let's take them one at a time. The money's coming from where?
Yeah, so we have a couple different options here. So first, the general idea is that there are sort of two product offerings that we have. The first is the television base, which is what you spoke about, which we've talked with Tom or Sheriff Dart about and have installed there in Cook County. So that has come primarily through grant funding. And so the MacArthur Foundation and some others have stepped up. The Chicago Community Trust have been others who have been very helpful in that regard. And so that's from a funding perspective. We actually hope to make the television a free offering to jails across America. We really appreciate Chicago for being very groundbreaking. I mean, Sheriff Dart's extremely progressive in this space, so he's been the one to really push it forward. And the way there are some other developments too that will help us to make it so it's completely free to the jails, fully. But like Sheriff Dar mentioned, very minimal cost at this point. Really nothing, just more operationally. There's some hardware we have to install and things like that to get it in there. And so that's pretty exciting. And then there's definitely more coming. We'll keep you put the dot 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 there to keep you on excited about what's coming. But it will also be helpful to enhance some of the work of the library as well. I think the second question you asked is, as far as what
type of programming? I think one of our viewers, Ryan, was asking, are we talking about, you know, just literacy projects? Are we talking about, you know, a math class on TV? I know I mentioned some self-help stuff. Kind of some guidelines.
For sure. Great question. So there's an array of topics. The first thing we did was we went to inmates and asked, you know, what is it that you need? What is it that you want? And we spent a lot of time with reentry and service providers to figure out what is it that you're seeing the needs are on the outside. We essentially have five or six categories, depending on how you break them out. The first is sort of your raw education, so that's everything from college curriculum to GED and literacy, ESL, those types of topics. The second piece is some of the legal information. That's one of the things in the greatest demand. So helping people understand the system, helping them understand what a public defender is, and sort of the aspects and challenges that they face on the legal side. Third is more of the cognitive behavior stuff, so anger management and some of the things like just, you know, setting goals, thinking about your thinking. I guess you could say some of the self-help aspects. Substance abuse falls into that category. Fourth is community, helping them understand and identify resources within the community. So organizations like the Safer Foundation in Chicago or St. Leonard's and TASC and organizations like that. And then the fifth is what we really consider sort of an exploratory topic, and that's things like TED Talks and major documentaries that would be helpful, or health information, as well as we sort of put health and wellness in that as well, meditation and yoga and some of these other things. So really trying to provide a well-rounded aspect, lineup of programming to touch on everybody. Every interest as they spend their time. I think it's also one. Just one other thing to note too. That's I think important to recognize about jails. The comment was made earlier. Why don't we spend the money to educate people who aren't in jail? And to distinguish between jails and prisons. Jails are pre-trial, so this is a population that has not been convicted. And so, in reality, any of us could be in jail for a false conviction tomorrow. And so, it's one thing to want to maybe limit resources that go into prison populations that are convicted, but I do think it's important to always recognize that jails are a pre-trial scenario for most, and that these people are there innocent until proven guilty, unless we believe that that's not true. So.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's a very good point. How did you become interested in this? There's not a lot of people doing what you're doing, so I'm wondering what sort of turned you on to this.
Yeah. We wish there were more people doing this, but my dad taught in prisons when I was growing up, and so that was at a very early age. That was something I at least had it. Access to and had been, because prisons and jails don't usually enter the lives of most nuclear families. And so the other piece I think was most recently I was doing a JD MBA program at Northwestern in Kellogg, and when I was working on a social impact bond for Cook County, they were trying to reduce the jail population, and that was really what brought me back into this space. And we were trying to identify ways in which we could bring down the jail population here in Cook County because it's sort of busting at the seams which is the single largest jail in the nation. And so in that effort, we just realized that this might be a way in which we can scalably reach the entire audience, whereas everything else is extremely costly. The TVs are already in place, and so we have an ability to use the existing infrastructure and bring the message to them, to every single inmate, whether they're protected custody, high security, or just going to be there for the day.
Do you have any numbers as to how it lowers the recidivism rate? I mean, I know that this is obviously fairly new, and you probably haven't done much, long-term research or studies on it, but, I mean, what are you thinking at this point?
No, for sure. That's definitely where we're focused, and I think, again, some of our future product offerings will be even more effective than what we are initially launching with. And that's why MacArthur came on as well. They want to identify how this affects recidivism rates as well. So definitely on our radar. Recidivism rates usually take about 3 years to clearly identify. Records on that. That is the hypothesis, and we're definitely tracking that as we come online.
All right.
I don't think the sheriff would have allowed us to do it otherwise.
Okay. Well, I think this is going to wrap up our Google Hangout for tonight.
I just want to add really quickly that we just posted Lourdes' story, the full video and script, to our website, WGNTV.com. We also posted the link to our Google Plus page. So, if you want to watch it again, if you haven't had a chance to watch it, it's up, and you can check it out.
Excellent. So.
And let us know what you guys thought of the Google Hangout, if we need to do something different and how we can fix it and make it better for the next time we do it, because I'm sure we'll be doing a lot more of these.
Yeah, and if you guys need help, I'll be able to help you guys out, because since I've done this before, and I can give you some tips and I can make it better.
All right. Thank you so much, Daniel. Mike, thank you so much for all your wonderful questions, and of course, Brian, for answering some of them for us. Good luck with your project.
Appreciate it. Thanks, Florida.
All right, everyone.
Good night, everybody.
Thanks, Lourdes.
All right, take care, Lourdes.
All right, bye.